5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Sir, I am thankful to the honorable members who have participated in this debate and generally welcomed the measure before the House. This amending measure of the Motor Vehicles Act, as honorable members may perhaps recollect, has had a very checkered career, and in fact this amending process started 10 years back. It went to the select committee stage and a certain finality was given to it at that time. Then it could not be pushed through. Later events made it necessary for further changes to be made in the amending measure, and I should think that this amending bill has come at a very opportune moment before the House, when the whole emphasis in the context of our planning is on the development of more and more transport capacity. I should like honorable members to view this question in that aspect, and if they do so, they will find that this bill provides for and enables various steps to be taken so that transport capacity can be fully developed. There was some mention about nationalization, and I thought the opposition to it, if any, was very mild and had become thoroughly modified in the course of these few months. It has come to stay, and that has been very well realized by honorable members who were not perhaps so happy as others regarding this question of nationalization. So let us consider what is the task that is to be done by the various transport systems in the country, rail, road, and so on. There is a huge task to be performed by all these. They have to go hand in hand and perform this huge task. It is well known that the rail transport capacity that will be generated in the course of the next few years will not be able to move all the traffic. We have said so on several occasions. The allotment of resources for the purpose of railway planning and development falls very much short of the requirements. Even as per the original targets, the railways have to expand their capacity by about 42 or 43 million tons, and the additional traffic that will be generated was calculated as 60 and odd million tons. So even as per the original targets, there was a gap of 17 to 18 million tons. Now certain targets have undergone an upward revision, for instance, for cement production. It is roughly calculated that the cost of the railway plan will have to go up by another rupees 100 crores to move these additional 50 million tons. So when there is so much to move, and when there is so much traffic offering, there is no question of conflict between rail and road transport. Rail and road transport have to join hands and lift the traffic that will be generated. Viewed from this angle, it will be found that there is no conflict. One honorable member referred to this matter and said that the railways should not adopt a dog in the manger policy. I have no difficulty in agreeing with him. The railways do not propose to follow a dog in the manger policy. Perhaps the honorable members does not know that we have taken various steps towards relaxation of restrictions on inter-regional transport, which he was mentioning. He spoke from experience and said that he was a member of one regional transport authority. Even as far back as 1994, this subject was considered and state governments were advised to relax the restrictions that they were having both on private carriers and public carriers. They were asked to give the utmost freedom to private carriers. Perhaps the position is not very well realized that in our country, the majority of the trucks are only public carriers. In other advanced industrialized countries, the majority are private carriers. It has been brought out in the report of the study group which went into this question that perhaps 70 to 80% of the total number of trucks are in private hands. Here also, in our country, the various industrial establishments, new and old, can really go in for owning and operating more and more private carriers. They can own a large fleet and can have workshop facilities also, and they need not complain against the railways for not carrying things. So the indication is that private industries and new plants and new units that are going to be set up can very well go in for owning a large fleet of private carriers which can carry goods over small distances. Of course, over very long distances, it may not be possible to operate private carriers through. Even there, it will be possible to operate over long distances to some extent. So, there is no question of any conflict, as I said, between rail transport and road transport. Coming to road transport, let us see whether the nationalization policy of the state governments comes in the way of expansion of private road transport. Mr. Chairman, I wish to support this bill not because this is really a measure which will improve the conditions under which these institutions have come into existence in our country, but because I feel even a small thing like this, which will regulate the running of these homes, might do some temporary good. If we examine the reasons why these homes have come into existence, we will find that it is really a reflection on the social backwardness, because women are not educated, because women do not have the right to own property. Naturally, they are deserted, neglected, and are driven to the necessity of doing into these homes run by the men in our society. These people run these homes under the guise of public charity, but these homes have really become centers of immoral traffic in our cities. These institutions are not only not run by the state as they should be, but they are run by religious.